Well, good morning. It's good to be with you today, and I am looking forward to today. I'm looking forward to the great music, and I'm looking forward to the message that God has for each and every one of us. I pray that your spirit has been resurrected as Christ was resurrected so many years ago. God bless you with his presence during today's service.
Welcome from the Lone Star Cowboy Church of Nevada County. Thank y'all for joining us for today's service. We hope you receive a blessing from the message. We are blessed to celebrate Easter with y'all today. Easter is the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus from the tomb on the third day after his crucifixion. Easter is fulfilled prophecy of the Messiah who would be persecuted, die for our sins, and raise on the third day. In Luke chapter 24, verses 6 and 7, he is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with y'all in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day rise again. Rejoice, Jesus is alive. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the resurrection of your Son, Jesus. We want to celebrate him every day of our lives. In a world that grows increasingly dark, help us hold up his light. Give us the courage to speak boldly. Never be ashamed of proclaiming your good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, folks. In Luke chapter 10, verse 27, he answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself.
Today I started loving God again. I'm right back where I really should have been. I strayed just long enough to fill my heart with sin. Then today I started loving God again. What a fool I was to think I could get by without the love of Jesus in my life. I should have known the best was yet to come, and that healing time for me had just begun. 'Cause today I started loving God again. I'm right back where I really should have been. I strayed away just long enough to fill my heart with sin. Then today I started loving God again. What a fool I was to think I could get by without the love of Jesus in my life. Well, I should have known the best was yet to come. And that crying time for me just begun. Cause today I started loving God again. Well, I'm right back where I really should have been. I strayed away just long enough to fill my heart with sin. Then today I started loving God again. Then today I started loving God again.
Amen. Thank you, buddy. Today we started loving our God again. Amen. In Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
My grandpa taught me about bug knives and shotguns, how to cast an OZEF coat, how to work a stick shift. He taught me the Bible about all 12 disciples, and he made sure that I know there's life after this, with pearly gates and streets of gold. Said if I just believe, that's where I'll go. Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven, where there's dirt roads for miles, hay in the fields, and fish in the river, where there's dogwood trees and honeybees and blue skies and green grass forever. So Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven, now it says in the King James, in Almighty's kingdom, he mentions a mansion that's built just for me. Now I'd gladly trade it for a farmhouse with acreage, and a backyard that's shaded, and a squeaky front porch swing. That's where I want to hang my wings when I die. I want to live outskirts of heaven, where there's dirt roads for miles, hay in the fields, and fish in the river, where there's dogwood trees and honeybees and blue skies and green grass forever. Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven. Yeah. Good Lord knows me, He knows I need blue skies and green grass forever. Lord, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven. Yeah, when I die, I want to live on the outskirts of heaven.
Amen. Thank you, Sloan. We hope y'all enjoy the rest of the service. Just keep on praying. Thank y'all.
Well, amen. I tell you, aren't we so fortunate to have such a great band? I always look forward to showcasing different people from the band each and every week. And our buddy Tommy Pryor was supposed to be here today with Buddy, but Tommy got to feeling under the weather. And so I want to thank Sloan for stepping in and helping during this time. But anyway, we are so blessed to have such a great band. We've got about 12 people in our band. And I just enjoy, with these video services, I enjoy showcasing just a couple of them each and every week. But thank you guys. Again, just powerful job. And I want to thank everybody who makes these videos possible, with Margie on the soundboard and Charles doing all the video, and Tim making sure all the music was ready and prepared. And so anyway, I want to thank each of them for being a part. Well, it's a good day, and it's good to be in your house with you today, ready to worship the Lord. And let's just go to the Lord in prayer at this time and invite His presence into this church where I'm at and into your homes where each of you are. Let's pray. Father, we just love you and praise you, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. Lord, we thank you that you look down upon us with a smile on your face. Lord, you don't look down upon us with anger and frustration and bitterness, but God, you look down upon us as your children, and we praise you for that. Lord, we want to thank you for what happened 2,000 years ago on that cross, Lord. And we want to thank you for what happened in that tomb just 3 days later, when that rock was moved to the side and our Lord and Savior came out of that tomb victorious over death and over hell and over sin. We thank you, Lord, that we get to reap the benefits of what He did for us so many years ago, Lord. And I pray that today would be a time of worship for us as we again hear the story of the resurrection. Lord, I pray that you would take this message today and help us understand and have new thoughts, new truths. And Lord, I pray that we would be challenged and transformed. Lord, I pray that we'd be able to take this message that He is risen, and that it would we'd be able to take it throughout this next year and share that with other people, that our Savior has risen. But we love you, Lord, and we praise you. And that's why we're here today, because we just want to be in your presence. And it's in your name I pray. Amen. Well, first of all, this is Easter Sunday. And if you remember, we said that we were going to give away this TV on Easter Sunday. And you guys have purchased tickets. And we've been dropping them in the old bucket here. And so today's the day. Today is the day we've got to determine who won this 65-inch color TV, flat screen, plasma, all the good stuff, and we got to determine who won it. Now, it's going to be a little bit of a challenge because you do have to be here to win the award. So let's go to the bucket here and let's see who's first, maybe first chance. Dana Collins. Dana Collins, are you here? Oh, I'm so sorry. Let's try again here. Maybe this one's the lucky ticket. Eddie Gregory. Is Eddie Gregory in the house? I'm so sorry, Eddie. Let's take a look again. Charky Marquez. Charky, are you that? Well, that's me. Oh, I am so excited. I've wanted one of these for years. Thank you so much. And I will need help carrying this out to my car later on. I'm just kidding. We will give this away. We will, once we all get back in here and get busy again, we will be moving forward on our building project. And I want to thank Rick Slager for donating this to us. And we will continue to do the raffle for this TV. Once we're all able to get back together and just be in fellowship in this house again together. But I'd seen this, it was sitting in storage, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna have some fun with it today. And I wish I won it because I need it. But anyway, I'll give it a shot later on. In today's passage, we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 24, and this is the Resurrection Sunday. This is Easter Sunday. This is what we believe. This is what we as Christians have given our entire lives for, and that is for the fact of what took place on Easter so many years ago. Luke chapter 24, if you would have your Bible with you today, if you'd open it up and read along with me. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared, and they went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered it, they did not find the body of their Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man, he said, must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to the others. It was Mary Magdalene. It was Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and even the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what has happened. What an amazing story. And there's really lots of little nuggets of truth in there that if we had the time today, it would be fun to be able to kind of just gobble them up. Things such as women's role in this process. I enjoy the Luke because he helps us understand just how important the women were when it come to the gospel. And here are the first ones to get to the tomb were the women that day. That's a great little message, and I've talked about that in the past. I hope that you were here to hear about the women's role in the Bible and the women's role in the church and how important they are to the church and how important they are to the Word. But that's not what we're going to focus on today. What I want to focus on today is three points, and the first one we see is they had their spices, and they were going to prepare the body of Jesus, and that would have been something that would have been common at that time, and they had their, so they had their pouches or however they were carrying these things, and they're walking to the tomb. And can you imagine how grieved they were? Can you imagine their hearts were just broken because this one they loved so much, Jesus, they had given their entire lives for him. And now he was dead and gone, and the unknown and the fear that they had to have. You see, you wonder where the apostles were. Well, the disciples, where were they? Well, they were in fear. They were tucked away because they didn't know what was going to happen next. But these women, with boldness, they grabbed up these spices and they go to prepare the body of our Lord and Savior. But they have a challenge. See, they don't know how they're going to get this great big rock that was blocking the entrance of the tomb. They didn't know how they were going to get that removed. They were probably thinking, well, I hope that the Roman soldiers may help roll that stone away. But they don't know if he's going to or not. And so they had a challenge before them. How are we going to get this large stone out of the way? But here's one truth we got to remember. They went anyway. They knew they weren't going to be able to move that stone, but they just simply said, you know what? We've got to go be in the presence of our Lord. We've got to go try. We've got to go see what we can do and see if we can prepare the body of our Lord. As I think about this portion of the passage, I'm captivated with the thought that there's a large stone in front of them that they're going to have to figure out how to move out of their way. And church, we too find ourselves in times where we have stones in our way. We're going through life and all of a sudden we've got this large obstacle that's in our way and we don't know how we're going to remove it. We don't know how we're going to get it out of the way. Well, church, I want you to understand that just as that stone was rolled out of the way for those women, God is still in the stone rolling business. He is still removing stones out of our way. We too often live in fear. We too often are captivated by things ahead of us, and we don't know what we're going to do. We don't know how we're going to get through this. We don't know how we're going to get around this. We don't know what's going to take place in the midst of this. And God tells us, don't live in fear. Don't live in denial. Don't live in shaky faith. Live in confidence, understanding I am still in the stone rolling business. You don't have to live in fear about what's ahead of you. Just understanding I am going before you, God tells us, and I'm rolling those stones out of the way, so I'm making your path straight. And church, we need to be a people of confidence. We need to be a people who do not live in fear, but we need to be a people who live in faith. God didn't say, I want you to live a life of fear. He said, I want you to live a life of faith. And we as Christians can have that faith. There are stones in our way. There are stones that we don't know what we're going to do. But rather than living in fear, we just say, God's got this. He's in control. It don't matter what seems to be ahead of me. God will lead and guide and direct me right through this process. How many times or how much time have we spent in our life living in fear of the unknown, the fear of what is ahead? And once we get there, we realize God had got it all worked out. It was all okay. As I was thinking about this particular point, I'm always taken back to a couple of times in my life. One was, again, when my dad sold the shop and they told the bank wanted them to wanted him to break open the concrete and look and make sure that the tanks, the hydraulic tanks, weren't leaking. And that created a major financial situation for my dad. And it was going to be such a financial burden that it created a lot of anxiety in the family. And we began to pray for this situation and pray that we'd never have to break that concrete, that we wouldn't have to go down there and open up all those hydraulic tanks and make sure everything was okay. But God shared with me, God spoke to me in this particular moment. He said, Charkey, do not live in fear. Don't live in fear over this situation. Just live in faith. It is going to be okay. And man, the banker, he said, we ain't going to do that. We're just going to move forward. Man, that was a pretty big rock. And there was a lot of fear of what's going to take place if we do open that concrete up and the hydraulics been leaking. Then what takes place? But God told me, I can't say that he's spoken to me like this all throughout my life. But in this one particular instance, God really spoke to me. And he said, you live in faith. And church, that has changed my entire life from that moment on. I understand that I am just going to not worry about the rocks that are before me. I'm going to live in faith. And I'm just going to know that God is preparing the way. He's making my way straight ahead of me. As you think about this story, answer to yourself, who put the rock in front of the mouth of that tomb? Well, it was the soldiers, wasn't it? The soldiers rolled that rock in the way. This was a rock that was put in the way by somebody else. But as I was writing my message, and I talk about, you know, God to make your way straight and he'll clear your path, I was struck with the point or the thought that how often do we put our own rocks in our way? How often do we stack our own rocks in front of us? We make life difficult because of the choices we're making. And then we step back and we ask, why is God allowing this to happen to me? Guys, please don't be the person who makes those bad choices and starts doing dumbheaded things and then asks yourself, why would God allow me to suffer the consequences of all these sins or all of these issues? You see, God calls us to live a life of wisdom. God says, I want you to live a life of wisdom. And he gives us the word of God. And he says, if you would allow these precepts and these scriptures to so fill you that I will be able to manifest inside you a godly wisdom, then I can make your path straight. But church, if I'm making dumb-headed decisions and I'm making foolish decisions, then I will suffer the consequences of those foolish decisions. I'll suffer the consequences of those dumb-headed decisions I made. So always remember that God will lead and guide us and direct us. He'll make our path straight. But don't be the one who's putting the rocks in the way. This passage goes on, says this in verse 3. But when they entered, they did not find the body of their Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? That is such a powerful little passage. And I ask you, why do we so often look for the living among the dead? I believe each of us want these attributes in our life. I believe we want love in our life. Each one of us want to be loved. We want to have people to love, and we want people to love us. We want joy in our life. We want peace in our life. We want to be that person that that is surrounded by that joy and love and peace. And those are attributes that are given by God. But oftentimes we look for those attributes in the places of the dead. We look for these attributes in things such as alcoholism. We want love and joy and peace in our life, but we think that we have the most peace when we've been drinking. But is that really the peace that God wants us to have? Are we looking for peace in the midst of dead things? We look for love in relationships. We want love in our life, and so we start looking around and maybe finding ourselves getting involved in relationships that are not right and are not godly. But we think that we're getting love whenever we're indulging in things in relationships, even when they're out of line. We think that we can find peace and joy, not peace maybe, but we find joy in maybe that party lifestyle where we're going places because we want to be surrounded by people who are excited and doing fun things. And we find ourselves going to the club or to the bar and we just want to be accepted. We want to be loved and we want to love. And we think that those kind of things we could find in that party lifestyle. Or we may think that we find peace and money. And so we spend all of our time trying to gather all the money we can. And we are doing things that just create money and no time to spend with our family, no time to spend with our kids. And we think that our identity and love and peace may come from money. But church, I want us to understand today that anytime we look for things such as love and joy and peace, things that are contrary to the word of God, then we're looking for those things in dead places. We're looking for the living among the dead. All too often, we find ourselves looking for the living among the dead. Always ask yourself, church, ask yourself constantly, what would God want me to do in this situation? Maybe you're in a situation, it's a relationship situation, and you know this person's not a Christian. And you ask yourself, what would God want me to do in this situation? Does God really want me to toy with sin, or does God want me to find a godly person to live my life with? Ask yourself, what would God want me to do in this situation? Maybe it's somebody's trying to get you to compromise financially in a situation, and you know it's not right, but it would create a large amount of money. Ask yourself, what would God have me do in this situation? Don't look for the living among the dead. Don't let the devil deceive you into believing that you find love, joy, and peace among dead things. David thought he would find love in the arms of another woman, in another man's arms of another man's wife. And all that created was the death of her husband, the loss and the death of his son, and guilt and shame that David had to battle from that point on. Judas thought he would find security and peace and happiness in a bag of money. And he turned over his Lord and Savior for 30 pieces of silver. And all that got him was guilt and shame and suicide. The prodigal son thought he would find happiness and love and joy in the party lifestyle. And he soon realized that that party lifestyle sent him to the pig pen. Don't be a people who look for the living among the dead. Be the people who say, I want love and joy and peace in my life, and I know I get those things only as I spend time with the Lord. I know I want joy, peace, and love in my life, and I find those things only whenever I'm following in the will and the plan that God has before me. As I'm in God's presence, I have joy, I have peace, and I have His love. But when I step aside from God's presence and I begin to live amongst the things of the dead, I find myself suffering the consequences of those things. And as these angels ask these ladies, why do you look for the living among the dead? I got to ask you today, why are you finding yourself looking for the living among the dead? Be a people who are wise and say, I want love, I want joy, and I want peace in my life. And so I'm going to follow Jesus where I truly find these attributes. Turn to the Lord. Allow the Lord to be the one who gives you the love that you're looking for. Allow the Lord to be the one who gives you the joy that you've longed for. And allow the Lord to be the one who gives you the peace that surpasses all understanding. In our last part of the scripture today, in verse 6, listen to this. He is not here, the angel said. He is risen. He is risen. That's what we as Christians have based our entire lives around. That's what I know me and myself. I have given my entire life to that fact because I believe completely and fully that my Lord and my Savior has risen. Because He's risen, we as Christians are a new creation in Christ. The Lord, or the old things have passed away in our life and new things have come. Because He has risen, that old life is now behind us, and we now can serve and to follow our Lord and Savior. He has risen, and because He's risen, we too have risen. We've risen in several areas, and one way we've risen is we have risen above the chains of sin. In Romans 3, verse 33-37, it says this, "No, in all things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us." You see, we don't need to be captivated by these sin things anymore. We don't need to be captivated by these things of the dead any longer. We can say no to sin. We can see the consequences of sin now because we have the Holy Spirit within us. And we can say, I know that those are things of the dead. And I'm not going to do those things. I'm going to follow Jesus. You see, we've been risen above the chains of sin. In Romans chapter 6, verse 22 and 23, it says this, "But now you are free from the power of sin." You are free from the power of sin. It no longer has control over you. It says this, it says, "You have become slaves of God." Now, that word slave, he was using that because he was wanting to use illustrations that they could understand. And he was saying that you are now bound to something new. You used to be a slave to sin. Now you're a slave to the Lord. This would also work. But now you are free from the power of sin and have become sons of God. Now you do those things that lead to holiness and result in eternal life. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, we are free. We have received that free gift of eternal life, and we no longer have to allow sin to control us. We have broke those chains in our lives. We see the consequences of those sins, and we say, I don't want nothing to do with that stuff. It brings death. It brings destruction. It brings chaos. I'm going to follow Jesus. When Jesus rose from the dead, we too have raised, and we have raised from the chains of sin. We have also risen from the condemnation of sin. In Romans chapter 8, verse 1, it says this, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You see, what I love about that passage is God doesn't look down upon me with hate and anger and frustration. He looks down upon me as a son, and he says, I love you, Charky, and I'm going to lead and guide and direct you. And at that moment where I've fallen short, and I've got to confess that I have fallen short. I am not always perfect in all things. Sometimes I do things that are dumbheaded and stupid, but God doesn't look down upon me and say, pow, just kick me out because I've fallen short. God looks down upon me and he says, I got a better plan for you, Charky. I've got a better idea for you. I don't want you to live that way. And as I repent, he cleans me off. He dusts me back. He dusts me off. And he says, come on, I got a better plan for you. But God is not up there as a God who's just wanting to condemn you. Because of what Christ did on the cross, we are saved. And there's no condemnation for us who are in Christ Jesus. Let's be a people who say, Lord, I don't want to be a person who is indulging in sin. I want to be that person who's following you with all joy and all peace and all love. But I thank you, Father. I thank you that you're not there condemning me. I thank you that you're leading and guiding and directing me. And Father, if I fall short, Father, forgive me and clean me up. And get me back on the right path. Because I want to glorify you in everything I do. Lastly, we will one day be risen to God's presence for all eternity. Revelations chapter 21. It's a great, great scripture. Remember where it's at. Revelations chapter 21, verse 1. This is John the Revelator writing. And he pins down what he seen. And he says this, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw a holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more mourning, no more crying, no more pain. For the old order of things have passed away. You see, God has risen us up in his resurrection. We too have been risen. We've been risen above the chains of sin. We no longer have to be bound by sin. We can say no to those sins. We have been risen above the condemnation of sin. We don't have to live with the fear of being condemned because of our sin, because of what Christ did for us. He has forgiven us, and we are purified in him. And there will be a day when we will be risen to God, into God's presence. And I love this passage where it says that there will be no more tears. And it says he will wipe every tear from their eye. Now think about that. That's a very intimate moment. That tells me that we will stand right there in the presence of our Lord. And he will be the one who wipes those tears from our eyes. What a powerful encounter. And I look forward to that day whenever I stand in God's presence and I have been risen above this world. I no longer have to deal with consequences of a fallen world, but I will be in God's eternal presence. Church, I want each one of us to be there that day. I want each one of us to be a people who rise above these sins. I want us to be a people who rise above the condemnation of sin. And I want us to be a people who someday who stand in the presence of the Lord. Church, we celebrate Easter because we celebrate a risen Savior. We celebrate that Lord who came down and lived the sinless life. He did something we couldn't do. And he was that ultimate sin sacrifice for us. Do we understand all that there is about why it had to be a blood sacrifice? You know, no, I don't. We may not always understand all the fine details, but what we do understand is Jesus took the call and he said, I will be that ultimate sacrifice. And he came and he allowed his blood to be spilt for you and for I. And I got to ask you today, do you believe it? Have you received that blood? Our scripture today, one of our scriptures said that salvation is a free gift that he gives to you for free. All you have to do is accept it. And if you're there today and you realize that you need a Savior, then I want to give you an opportunity today to find that Lord, that Savior in your life. It's as the scripture tells us that it's a simple confession. It's an acknowledgement that you do need that Savior. And it's a confession of our sin. And it's a repentant heart and repentant spirit. And what that tells me is what it means is as I all of a sudden realize that I have been walking separate from the Lord. And God knocks on my heart's door and says, I have a new plan for you. I have a better plan for you. And I repent of my sins and ask him to be the Lord of my life. And I turn and I begin to follow the Father. You see, I want that joy in my life. I want that love in my life. And I want that peace in my life. And I know that those things come when I'm in God's presence, when I'm living among the living, not living among the dead. If you find yourself, you've been living among the dead far too long. You need God's love. You need his presence. You need his peace. Let's pray and invite God's presence into your life. Let's invite him into your life. Let's pray. I'm going to pray a simple prayer. There's no magic word that I'm praying. What I'm praying is a heart's desire. And if your heart's desire is the Lord today, and you mean it with all your heart, then simply say this prayer after I. Dear Heavenly Father, I have been living among the dead far too long. And I ask you to become the Lord of my life. And allow me to live among the living. Allow me to rise above sin. Rise above the condemnation. And Father, I want to be in your presence in heaven someday. So I ask that you would take my sin. I ask that you would forgive me. And I ask that you'd be the Lord of my life. I thank you for what took place 2,000 years ago on the first Easter morning. And I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior. And I will forever praise you. And it's in your name. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, God bless each and every one of you. I hope there's somebody out there today who's been so touched by the Lord that you made that your prayer and that God used today's message to be life-changing. God bless you. I love each one of you. Stay encouraged. Let's get through this quickly so we can get back over here. Man, we got too much stuff to do to all be a part. But stay encouraged during this time. Love you guys. God bless you.